Hello students, welcome back to my channel. Today we are going to discuss about the jam jelly marmalade part 3. In part 3 we will discuss about the different kind of topics like introduction to pectin, determination of pectin and judging of endpoint. As we all knows, for jelly preparation pectin plays an important role. Without pectin content we cannot form the jelly. So we can divide the foods in different category on the basis of pectin as well as acid content. So there are four different categories: rich in pectin and acid, rich in pectin but low in acid, low in pectin but rich in acid, and low in pectin as well as in acid. So first we'll discuss about the introduction to pectin. Actually, what is pectin? Pectin is substance present in the form of calcium pectate are responsible for the firmness of fruits. Pectin is the most important constituent of jelly. It is a commercial term for water soluble pectinic acid, which under suitable conditions form a gel with sugar and acid. In the early stage of development of the fruits, the pectin substance is a water insoluble protopectin, which is converted into pectin by the enzyme protopectinase during ripening of the fruit. In overripe fruits, due to the presence of pectin methyl esterase enzyme, the pectin gets largely converted to pectic acid, which is water insoluble. This is one of the reason that the both immature and overripe fruits are not suitable for making jelly and only ripe fruits are used. The setting of pectin is also dependent upon the pH and sugar concentration. Stiffness of the gel increases with increasing concentration of pectin up to a certain point, beyond which the addition of more pectin has little effect. Too little pectin gives a soft syrup instead of gel. Pectin tends to keep the sugar from crystallizing by acting as protective colloid, but is not effective when the concentration of sugar is 70% or more. So it means we should keep in mind that the sugar concentration should be below the 70% for making the good form of jelly. The gelling power of fruit pectin depends upon the amount of pectin used as well as its degree of polymerization and acetyl content. The amount of pectin extracted varies with the method of extraction, the ripeness of the fruit, the quantity of the water added for the extracting the juice, and the kind of fruit. Usually about 0.5 to 1% of pectin of good quality in the extract is sufficient to produce good jelly. If the pectin content is higher, a firm and tough jelly is formed, and if it is less, the jelly may fail to set. It means we have to just watch out that the proper amount of pectin content should be there in our product, then only jelly will be formed. So how we can determine the pectin content in our product? So there are different kind of testings from which we can estimate the pectin content. First test is alcohol test. This method involving precipitation of pectin with alcohol. In this, what we have to do? Only we have to take the 1 tablespoon of strength extract in a beaker. Then we have to cool it, and 3 teaspoons of the methylated spirit are poured gently down the side of the beaker. which is rotated for mixing and allowed to stand for a minute. So what are the result can be there? First, if extract is rich in pectin, a single transparent lump or clot will be formed. An equal amount of sugar is to be added to the extract for preparation of jelly. It means if we are getting a lump or clot of single transparent, then we have to add the sugar equal to the juice which we are taking for making the jelly. So pectin content will decide the amount of the sugar, how much sugar we have to add. Number two, if extract contains a moderate amount of pectin, what will happen? The clot will be less firm and fragmented. So what we need to do, we have to take the 3/4 of the amount of sugar in comparison to extract which we are going to be added. Number three, if extract is poor in pectin, what happened? Numerous small granule clots will be seen, and what we have to do, we have to take the 1/2 of the amount of sugar in comparison to extract. Second one is gel meter test. In gel meter test, what we have to do? The gel meter test is held in the left hand with the thumb and forefinger. The bottom of the gel meter tube is closed with the little finger. The strained extract is poured into the gel meter with a spoon held in the right hand till it is filled to the brim. While still holding the gel meter, the little finger is removed from the bottom and the extract is allowed to flow or drip for exactly 1 minute, at the end of which the finger is replaced. The reading of the label of extract in the gel meter is noted, and this figure indicates how many parts of sugar are to be added to the one part of the juice. Next is acid. The gelling of extract depend on the amount of acid and pectin present in the fruit. Of the three acid, citric acid, malic acid and tartaric acid found in fruits, tartaric acid give the best result. The final jelly should contain at least 0.5%, preferably 0.75%, but not more than 1% total acid, because a larger quantity of acid may cause the synersis and weeping problem. I already told you synersis is a oozing out the fluid from the jelly. So this oozing out can attract the microbes and they can attract the microbes and spoil our jelly. pH of the extract. So jelly strength increase with the increase in pH until optimum is reached. Further addition of acid decreases the jelly strength. The optimum pH for the jelly containing 1% pectin is approximately 3.0 to 3.2 and 3.4 and 60 for 3.0, 60% TSS will be there, 3.2 65% TSS will be there, and 3.4 for 70% TSS will be there. The pH of the jelly can be controlled by adjusting pH of extract with acid and alkali, adding a suitable buffer. Fruits also contain salt like a sodium citrate, sodium potassium, tartrate, etc., which have buffering action and helps to control pH. In general, the optimum pH value of jelly is 3.2. Next is sugar. This essential constituent of jelly imparts to it sweetness as well as body. If the concentration of sugar is high, jelly retains less water, resulting in the stiff jelly, probably because of the dehydration. Inversion of sugar. When the sugar, means sucrose, table sugar, is boiled with an acid, it is hydrolyzed into dextrose and fructose. The degree of inversion depending on the pH and duration of boiling. Because of the partial inversion of the sucrose, a mixture of sucrose, glucose and fructose are found in jelly. This mixture is more soluble in water than sucrose alone, and hence the jelly can hold more sugar in solution without crystallization. Next topic is judging of endpoint. How we can judge that our jelly is reached endpoint and we should stop the cooking? So what we have to do, boiling of the jelly should not be prolonged because excessive boiling results in the greater inversion of sugar and destruction of pectin. So we should keep in mind that we should boil it proper time. It should not be prolonged, otherwise destruction of pectin occurs. If jelly is cooked for prolonged period, it may become gummy, sticky, syrupy and deteriorate the color as well as the flavor. So there are some tests by which we can see that the endpoint is reached or not. First is sheet or flake test. Sheet or flake test, in this what we have to do, a small portion of jam is taken out during the boiling in a spoon or wooden ladle or cooled slightly. Then it is allowed to drop. If the product falls off in the form of sheet and flake instead of flowing in a continuous stream of syrup, it means that the end point has been reached and the product is ready. Otherwise, boiling is continued till the sheet test is positive. Next one is drop test. In drop test, concentrated mass is poured into a glass containing water. Then settling down of the drop without disintegration denotes the end point. Next one is temperature test. A solution containing 65% total soluble solids boils at 105 degrees Celsius. Heating of the jelly to this temperature would automatically bring the concentration of solids to 65%. This is the easiest way to ascertain the endpoint. Content is referred from the book Fruits and Vegetable Preservation by R.P. Srivastava and Sanjeev Kumar. Thank you guys for listening my lecture. Don't forget to subscribe my channel. Have a good day.